So I was watching Cherry Baguette's excellent video on Dutch politician Thierry Baudet, and there was mention of a phrase that Baudet had used in the past.
Flirten met hele extreme ideeën. U praat over de boreale wereld. U praat over homeopathische verdunning.
And that phrase, boreal world, stuck out to me because of its similarity to a topic that I had been researching lately. I looked into it some more, and I found that Baudet had used a variant of this phrase 2 years earlier in 2017 at his party's first congress, where he said, "Our boreal Europe," which is, again, kind of a weird phrase. The only mainstream usage of this term, boreal Europe, I could find was in an academic sense, where it only refers to the farthest northern regions of Europe, like Scandinavia, and only in the context of climatology and plant science. And by most definitions climatologically, the Netherlands wouldn't even be considered part of this region. So I contacted Cherry Baguette, and she confirmed, yeah, this is not a commonly used phrase in the Netherlands. And she pointed me in the direction of where Baudet very likely heard this phrase from. This same phrase had been used by others in the European far right. Jean-Marie Le Pen, not to be confused with his similarly named daughter, Marine Le Pen, said in a 2015 interview, "This is why we imperatively need to get along with Russia to save boreal Europe and the white world. Boreal Europe includes the Slavs, but also Siberia, which I fear the Russians cannot protect alone." He later defines boreal Europe further. Boreal Europe, that is to say, from Brest to Vladivostok. From Brest to Vladivostok, that's another weird phrase to use. Vladivostok is often considered the furthest east major Russian settlement, but in the west, Brest isn't the furthest western point of Europe, so it's a seemingly odd choice. But in actuality, it was calculated. The popularizer of that phrase, boreal Europe, among the European neo-fascists, was a member of the 33rd Waffen Grenadier Division of the SS, known as the Charlemagne Regiment. That man, René Benet, popularized the phrase from Brest to Vladivostok as part of a far-right ideological campaign for a single centralized European power that would at its base include France, Germany, Italy, and the USSR. The Charlemagne SS division that Benet was a member of participated in the Battle of Berlin in defense of the Führer bunker, and were among the last of the Nazi forces to surrender. These were the true believers of the Nazi regime at the very end. Among these true believers was a man named Maurice Martin, who often went by the alias Robert Dunn. Dunn was a compatriot of René, not just within the SS Charlemagne division, but also later in the far-right political circles of France. Dunn advocated for a federation of ethnic nations that would lead to an Aryan world state. The ideas of Dunn and Benet, among others, became the backbone for an idealized European federation of nationalist states, which would cooperate on the basis of their shared, white, boreal, Aryan identity. The goal of this concept was a single contiguous state over the whole of Europe and Russia, which would serve as a world power and a homeland for the Aryan race. If this sounds similar to something that the Nazis would dream up, that's because it was literally formulated by former SS members. This idea, popular among the French far right, is also popular today among white nationalists across Europe, but especially in Russia. And in Russia, the idea of a widespread racially homogeneous state also has a long history. In the 1920s, the newly formed Soviet Union was faced with an issue of ethnic national cohesion. One solution to this issue was that of the Eurasianists, who proposed the creation of a common ethnic substratum, essentially an invented culture of unity that members of the Soviet Union would enter into in the interest of national unity. Thereby, the nation would be unified under a single Eurasian identity, which would be applicable to all within the USSR. This ideology ended up having issues of its own and was ultimately unsuccessful. But the reason I bring it up is because this idea has had a modern resurgence. Neo-Eurasianism began in the era surrounding the collapse of the Soviet Union. And it took the same basic concept of a created cultural identity, but was reimagined by various groups. One major proponent and architect of Neo-Eurasianism is Putin advisor Alexander Dugin, who stated, "The ethnic or racial interpretation of events has always been one of the most forceful, hypnotic, and captivating." Dugin's Neo-Eurasianism is intentionally compatible with the ideas of Dunn and Benet, of a pan-European white nationalist state. There's a real practical issue of identity here, though. For example, you can't just tell a French person, "Hey, those people in Russia speaking a different language, using a different alphabet, and wearing funny hats, they're basically you. Trust me." the Neo-Eurasianists had to construct a new identity which would include all of the different cultural and ethnic groups that they wanted in their white homeland. While Dunn and Benet relied on the Nazi ideology of Aryan unity to connect all of Europe, the whole overt Nazi connection made it difficult for that to go mainstream after the war. So let's look at how others sidestepped around the Nazi problem. One step removed from the Aryan ideology is the concept of a Proto-Indo-European race. The Proto-Indo-Europeans are a hypothetical ancient population that spoke the Proto-Indo-European language, a theorized language which is widely thought to be the common ancestor of most languages between Europe and India. This theoretical group is most commonly believed to have existed sometime between 6 and 8,000 years ago, in the regions of the north coasts of the Black and Caspian Seas. The Proto-Indo-Europeans were first theorized in the 1800s due to similarities between certain European and Central Asian languages. In the 1900s, the theory was co-opted in the name of white ethnic nationalism, and was generally shortened from Proto-Indo-European to Aryan, from the Sanskrit meaning honorable, respectable, and noble. It was also popularized by Helena Blavatsky as part of the theosophical spiritual movement that she co-founded, and has a long history within esoteric fascism. Angie Speaks has a great video about Blavatsky and her role in esoteric fascism that goes into that in more detail. I'll link that in the description. One point I want to cover about Blavatsky, however, is her belief in something called Hyperborea. The word Hyperborea originates with the ancient Greeks, with the word itself meaning beyond the north winds. For the Greeks, it was a mythical utopia without disease or old age, where the sun was always shining. Blavatsky, among others, interpreted this myth to indicate that Hyperborea existed at or around the North Pole, which some now generally discredited theories suggested had a temperate or tropical climate at the time due to the Earth having a different axial tilt. Just to clarify, even though Proto-Indo-European is a real language family and was at one point probably a real language spoken by people, none of this stuff remains widely believed by any reputable scientist today. In other words, Proto-Indo-Europeans were not a white super-race that lived in a tropical Arctic wonderland. At the time, however, these ideas were relatively popular. William Fairfield Warren, the first president of Boston University, wrote a book in 1885 called Paradise Found, The Cradle of the Human Race at the North Pole. In this book, as implied by the title, he suggested that ancient humans originated at the North Pole, which he believed at one point was temperate and contained the Garden of Eden, and which he believed was also known by the names Atlantis and Hyperborea. If all this sounds familiar, it's because great pulp fiction authors like Edgar Rice Burroughs made extensive use of these concepts in fantasy and sci-fi stories of the early 20th century. But others, like alt-right and neo-Nazi favorite Julius Evola, repackaged these ideas specifically for a far-right audience. In his book, Revolt Against the Modern World, Evola frequently uses the term boreal interchangeably with the word Aryan, both in reference to peoples descended from Hyperborean ancestors. Evola also spoke of an ancient boreal masculine civilization that was opposed by a feminine southern civilization, and he stated that mingling of these two civilizations in ancient times resulted in degeneration. Unsurprisingly, Evola's writing is well-liked by our previously mentioned modern Neo-Eurasianist, Alexander Dugin. Dugin has been a key figure in the modern revival of the Hyperborean myth and its reintegration into white nationalist Aryan and Proto-Indo-European narratives. In Russia since the mid-90s, a Hyperborean origin for the Russian and Boreal peoples has been featured on TV shows and in a number of actual history textbooks which treat the idea with undue credibility. This myth has mainstream appeal due to a number of immediate issues that it solves for the Russian people. It establishes Russia as the seat of the first white civilization, which ruled all of Europe and the regions of the former USSR. Some of these myths even go so far as to make specific claims about the accomplishments of these civilizations, including that this ancient unified civilization founded the city of Troy, established the Sumerian state, settled Italy under the name Etruscans, and even that the civilization was the first to settle on the American continent. This ancient imagined history establishes a precedent for Russian rulership, or at least stewardship, over all the regions of the former USSR and any other European nations. It then also establishes a narrative of a simple, primordial conflict, that of the white, boreal north against the non-white south. This last myth especially is foundational for European white nationalists, not just those in Russia. And this theory also supports these groups in another way. It serves as a counter-narrative to the widely accepted out-of-Africa theory of human development. It revives an old idea, polygenism, which states that human beings either evolved entirely separately from an ancestor that would not be considered human, or dismisses the idea of evolution altogether, and prefers a mystical explanation for the creation of the world's various racial groups. You see from proponents of this idea the dismissal of genetic evidence that points to a single originating set of human ancestors, since that contradicts the idea of fundamental racial separateness and superiority. They say that genetic evidence is a conspiracy to try to trick them into surrendering their heritage. And as with most hateful and absurd ramblings of white nationalists, the people claimed to be responsible for this conspiracy are the Jews. That's right, anti-Semitism also has a place within the North versus South and polar myths of the Russian white nationalists. Their belief is that in ancient times, the Semitic peoples waged war against the polar ancestors with help from the global South, and that in defeat, the Boreal civilization was collapsed, scattered, and obscured from its descendants. Basically, they think Lord of the Rings is real, and they're all Aragorn. And with that mythical backing, the Russian nationalists see themselves as the saviors of white Europe against the encroachment of the global South supported by a vast Jewish conspiracy. These ideas have found fertile ground in the various European nationalist movements that have arisen over the last 5 years, as we can see from their reuse of anti-Semitic conspiracy theories that Jewish forces within the EU are forcing migration from the global South as some kind of destructive act upon Europe. This myth allows for similar explanations for basically everything the far right doesn't like. Feminism and LGBTQ rights, by the rules of this myth, are a degeneration of the natural masculine order spoken of by Evola. In this way, the myth is highly adaptable in its use against anything outside of the bounds of a traditional, white, patriarchal organization of society. And with all of that in mind, let's consider this rhetoric in action today. I think the most essential truth, that not many people have spoken before me, is that we as Dutch people have the right to be proud of our nation. All our political positions follow from that. Limiting immigration, smaller government, a European Union not interfering in our national matters, being proud of our history again, maintaining our own language at universities, not transferring money from the north to the south of Europe for sins of guilt or other feelings that we do not have the right to exist anymore. So, I think the fundamental truth that I tell people is we have a right to exist, to be proud of our country and defend it. The so-called ideology of human rights inherently refuses to recognize any kind of collective identity, including that of nationality and citizenship. Hence, we see provoked and uncontrolled migration, refugees, European self-hatred. The EU will necessarily continue the same politics of immigration, promoting transgenderism, transhumanism, postmodernity, and so on. Though Dugin is admired by and publicly supports many European far-right groups, such as Jobbik in Hungary, AfD in Germany, and the Freedom Party of Austria, among others, there are also clear indications of direct, covert cooperation between Dugin and other groups like these. Matteo Salvini, current Italian Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of the Interior, is a strong supporter of Russia and a far-right Euroskeptic. Salvini's longtime aide, Gianluca Savoini, claims to have known Alexander Dugin for over 20 years. In February of this year, one of Italy's most prominent newspapers, L'Espresso, published an investigation linking Gianluca Savoini to a Russian deal to finance Matteo Salvini's party, the Northern League, via a secretive oil deal. And Dugin has appeared as a guest of honor at a Northern League meeting in 2015, where his speech was preceded by the playing of the Russian national anthem in his honor. In a 2015 Facebook post following a speech by the President of Italy, Sergio Mattarella, Matteo Salvini posted this image of himself with the comment, "I would give to Mattarella in exchange for half of Putin." Emmanuel Leroy, one of Marine Le Pen's closest advisors and speechwriters, who has also used the phrase from Brest to Vladivostok and who is a supporter of Russia and Dugin, likely helped to write this section of a speech by Marine Le Pen in 2009. To rely on Russia today is to create the true European space from the Atlantic to the Urals, a Europe comprising nations pursuing their national interests and linked within a shared civilization, very different from the American ultra-liberal communitarian model toward which the European Union is driving us. And Christian Boucher, an officer from Marine Le Pen's party from 2008 to 2015, and also the publisher of many of Alexander Dugin's writings, has echoed a similar sentiment. Eurasia would be the natural evolution from a successful European federation, the stage after the Paris-Berlin-Moscow axis. But it is also, and we should keep this to ourselves, an essential component of our esotericism, the Third Rome, the Union of East and West, and so on. On June 13, 2019, following the European parliamentary elections, Marine Le Pen announced the formation of a new far-right coalition within the European Parliament, named Identity and Democracy. This coalition includes Matteo Salvini as a member, and is now the fifth largest coalition within the EU, with about 10% of all EU Parliament members. And so while some on the European far right are in favor of removing their nations from the EU, many, including Dugin and Bannon, are in favor of a realignment of the EU towards reactionary nationalism. In this goal, we can see a Europe that the neo-Eurasianists and the French Aryan nationalists would be quite pleased by. A Europe defined by a homogeneous racial makeup and an enforced return of traditional lifestyles. Politics today is moving in the direction of liberation. European managers can't stop this process. They can only continue it. More immigrants, more feminism, more open society, more gender. This line is unquestioned for the European elite. They can't change course, but the more time passes, the more people disagree with this. In response to this arises the reaction, which is gaining momentum in Europe and that the elite want to stop by her demonization. Reality ceases to conform to their project. Russia must save Europe from the liberal elite that are destroying it. We, Russians, are the heirs of the Roman, Greek, Byzantine tradition. We remain true to the spirit of the ancient European Christianity, which has lost all ties with this tradition. Russia can be a fulcrum to restore Europe. We Russians are more European than the Europeans themselves. We are Christians, heirs of the Greek philosophy. In 2016, Russian-born Ukrainian political analyst Vladimir Kornilov campaigned against the Dutch referendum on the establishment of a trade association agreement between the EU and Ukraine. Though Kornilov has denied political or financial links to Russia, leaked emails reveal contacts between him and Russian officials, including Alexander Dugin. At that time, he contacted various Dutch politicians and officials to try to pressure them into opposing the referendum. Among the groups contacted was the right-wing think tank turned political party, Forum for Democracy. And the head of that think tank at the time, and now the head of that party, is none other than Thierry Baudet, the man at the beginning of all of this. Baudet was outspoken in his opposition to the EU-Ukraine referendum, posting sensationalist anti-Ukraine fake news stories originating from Russian state-controlled media. Since the referendum, Baudet has remained a strong supporter of Russia, continuing to parrot Russian state media on a variety of issues like immigration and George Soros. I feel the need to clarify something here. I am not claiming in any way that Russia, via state actors, is exporting white nationalism and spreading it to these various countries. Instead, I believe that a coordinated subsection of the European white nationalist movement, which has been present for many years in each of these countries, are now coordinating to cultivate a shared ideological language. In doing so, they have adopted many of the positions proposed by Dugin, likely out of convenience or necessity. Russia happens to have a well-defined mythos and strategy for white nationalist propaganda that uses a shared understanding of whiteness that can be embraced and expressed by any white European. I want to clarify this to avoid the impression that I'm a Louise Mensch type jumping at Russian shadows, or that I believe this is all solely a Russian state propaganda operation. Though I believe that Russian state propaganda has been used by this movement, I would be extremely surprised if Putin believed in any of this esoteric stuff. But the thing is, Dugin's dreams for Europe don't require true believers in order to come true. For an upstart reactionary that just wants political power by any means, all this stuff is an easy and effective template for success in the European far right, especially if they are willing to make the right allies and use the right dog whistles. Baudet certainly knows the right dog whistles, and as far as the right allies, in addition to knowing Vladimir Kornilov, Baudet met with Dugin at the G10 Economic and Philosophical Summit in March of 2017, shortly after Baudet's party, the FVD, won their first two representative seats in the 2017 Dutch general elections. The next day, the two met and spoke for hours regarding the EU and the impending end of liberalism. In March of 2019, the FVD won the most Dutch representative seats of any one party. And in an interview, Dugin described his reaction to this news as great joy and great enthusiasm. He then went on to describe Baudet. One of the most intellectual thinkers I have ever met. a completely original and independent man, a rising star. He has a fantastic style, very classic, very attractive. I love the dandyism of Thierry Baudet. And if Baudet was just a Dutch nationalist that only cared about his country's people, then some of his actions don't make much sense. In May of 2019, in a televised debate with the current Prime Minister of the Netherlands, Mark Rutte, Thierry Baudet voiced his support for Russia's explanation for the destruction of Malaysian Airlines Flight 17 in 2015, against the prevailing conclusions of the International Joint Investigation Team, which concluded that the plane was shot down by Russian forces. The destruction of the plane resulted in the deaths of 298 people, 196 of whom were Dutch. Baudet experienced considerable backlash within the Netherlands for these statements. And so, like Salvini in Italy, Le Pen in France, and Trump in the US, we can see right-wing nationalists publicly supporting Russia and Russian interests even when it's not obviously politically convenient. If you didn't know any better, you might think, like a lot of American Democrats seem to lately, that Russia had something on these people, or was otherwise coercing them into these positions that seemed contrary to their nationalist populism. But once you look at things in a wider context, you can see that no compromat is required to explain the actions and motivations of these nationalists. Because ultimately, they're boreal nationalists. They're already on the same team.